If you recall, the third week of the month of January, I was teaching you about one of the most important command of the Lord. Therefore, go. That's the first thing that I teach you. It's about the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ who are in the mission. Everyone, the disciples are learner members of the church. That's a review. We are in the mission. In other words, believers in the Lord or in the churches of Jesus Christ today, there's a type of fellowship, but we are Christian in action. You do the work. In churches fellowship, study together, but 5 days a week, we have to do something that for personal, selfish, pleasurable thing, but for someone in that is expected by the Lord. Okay? So we are Christian in action. And by the way, all of us, if some of you at least one talent, and I don't believe you have one talent, there is what we call nature of talent or talents. There is what we call spiritual talent or spiritual gift, I should say. To some of you, you can sing, some of you can write and things like that, some of you can cook. So all these things given to you by the Lord Jesus Christ, it has something that you can offer back to Him. Is that always preaching in the pulpit? No. In fact, the people in the connecting of people out there is powerful than for us just standing and preaching to you, but we are discipling you, they're more powerful because they touch lives. And I talk about we have media, we have internet, we have all this communication today. If we can use that communication today positively, it will become a blessing. If we use it greedily, covetously for our own self, it will destroy you, some of this modern communication today, because either it is a negative or a positive, either it will destroy you or bless other people. So this kind of thing that you're holding, it can destroy a believer, a Christian in the Lord, because it's become a very, very strong goddess today. Anywhere you can see, you cannot talk to people anymore today. Even beside you, they're always in their mobile phone. No more talking. You can see sitting there, statue. Nobody said, how are you? Where are you from? No more. Everybody. They're walking there. I was in the park. They're walking with their mobile phone. The other one is in the mobile phone. You can say hi. They are not talking eye to eye. And even the Christian today in the room, they're not looking to each other. They're doing the one thing. Everybody is busy with this. Oh, use that media or internet for the glory of the Lord. So, find some way to use the gifts, natural talents, the gift of the Holy Ghost, spiritual gifting. There are about 26 of them. 9 gifting, which is the miracles and things to know, miracle and things like that. So we can use it for the Lord. Now today, we're going to study a very powerful study that is applicable, doable, pertinent, relevant in our time. It is a must in our time. So you can see the topic I would like to expound to you this afternoon is obedience without delay. Obedience without delay. Now this is a big topic in the history of the world. The big word obedience, it is big. Now you probably will ask me, well, how come it is so big? Because even the angelic beings, as you can see, when they were given such kind of honor and power, and they have the position of authority, they did not keep to their possession. They what? Disobeyed God, and so God cast them out into this planet Earth, and they become demons today, and they are doomed. They are in what we call they are chained today by the Lord. Some are loose, some are chained. Okay, and the bottom is split, and so those are angels become demons because of disobedience. Well, Adam and Eve, the point, they have everything, they have everything to enjoy, but later on, Eve, then Adam, what happened? They disobeyed the command of the Lord. And the result of that, because of one man's sin entered into the world, and death by sin, all of us become sinners, and the penalty of one man's action, the paternal head, by the name of Adam, though Eve was the person who committed sin, found by Adam, Diba? Ato the consequence, the corresponding effect of that, particular thing, is what happened. Very, very sad. You can see, number one, we will not stay forever in the planet Earth. We will all die. Number two, because of that, we have to work all the days of our life to be able to feed the family, to be able to buy, to pay for the house and the car. We're going to work so hard. And thirdly, we can see we become servant of sin, and we have no power to get away from the servant, to become servant of sin. So God took over and gave us the freedom. And fourthly, that because of that death of the paternal head, there is some kind of a future event for those. And by the way, hell is not prepared by the Lord for the people of God, but some of them, because of the paternal leadership of our head who disobey God, hell is created for Satan and for other people who does not keep their submission to the Lord. So you can see there, we can see Moses and then the nation of Israel, 2 million people, in they were promised to go to the promised land. And so you can see all of them died in the wilderness except for 2 men, Caleb and Joshua. In the younger generation, from 20 years old down, they were the only one who inherit and enjoy the promised land. So the word obedience is a big, big topic that we can see from the beginning of time, before the earth was created, before Adam and Eve was formed in the image of God, free from any kind of defilement or any no tainting of sin. We can see from the beginning, obedience is a big topic that even the angels, what happened, disobey God, and even Sodom and Gomorrah, these people, almost all of them disobeyed God, and God judged them, even the time of Noah. So you can see here, obedience is a big deal. That's why topic obedience without delay is a wonderful topic that we're going to study today. Now in the first study, you can see that God gave them the opportunity, and he said to one of the guys responded, "Lord, I want to follow you. I want to be a disciple. I want, oh Lord, to become your student. Lord, I'm so happy to be with you." And I can paraphrase more. And Jesus said, take note of this. Okay? Foxes have holes. The birds of the air, they have their nests. But the Son of Man, there is no security or place where he can lie his head. The other one said, Lord, come, follow me. Lord, there we can see the second point here, and the second word from the mouth of Jesus said, come, follow me. Lord, is it okay for you that because my father, in the context of that, the father's not dead. By the way, so to say, my father is about 78 years old. Maybe, Lord, if he lived about 5, 10 years ago, when my father died, I can follow you. And Jesus said, come, let the dead bury their dead. But you can see that person, he gave importance first to the family affiliation or affinity. There's nothing wrong with that, but approach it in the context. But God is calling, come follow me, I'll take over everything. Lord, can I bury my father before I follow you? So number one, to the obedience to the call of God, number one, take note of this, there is no negotiation. When God calls you, no negotiation. In other words, when there is an invitation to you, you are believers in the church, you are now believers in the Lord, I want you to come, follow me, I want you to become servant of God. When you obey God, there is no condition. No condition. You know, today, in here in Australia, in different nationalities, especially Asians, when you go to the Chinese or Korean store, any store, you can see people that are trying to lower the price by having a bargaining. Can I pay for this? How much the price? Can I buy this? $10? No, it's not. No. Maybe I can give you $40.50. Can I do it? $10.50? There's bargaining. So they want to bargain. They love to bargain. So here we can see that when the Lord calls you, there is no bargaining. There is no condition. It is given to everybody. It is not based when the Lord extended His voice to you, I want you, like Elena, our sister, from the Philippines, a second of November, October 24, in 1984, between 4 and 5 in the afternoon, she committed herself to the Lord. From then on, from 84 up to now, at the age of 73, is not in comparison. You can see that call was so precious to her, and no wonder if you're like, even in your own age, you still have this strength being that wait upon the Lord, shall renew your strength. They shall mount like, you know, with wings like an eagle. They shall run not weary, and they shall walk and not faint. So when God is extending His calling to you, it is not based in your convenience. It is not based in your convenience. Oh, you know, some pastors said, oh, I want to serve the Lord if we have a big church, not in the remote area, not in the valley, or not in a small place. And they asked many, many things. There's nothing wrong. God compensated the pastor. I knew that. I'm even here. But before you obey God, don't say, Lord, I want to have the saints, I have the saints, I have my car, I have my house, paid by the church. This is supported by the church. There's no question. But when God is calling you, just obey, submit to Him, and He will be faithful not to embarrass any one of us. Because God is not a man that He should lie, or the Son of God that He should repent. The moment we speak the word of God, it shall come to pass. Because He created the word, by His word. Now, when God extended the invitation to you, it is not based in your own timing. It's not in your timing. You know, Lord, I'll follow you, but in 2 years, I will quit there. I'll move to another place. Once I have my money, I can buy a little kind of investment. When I have a little investment, God, can I move to another place? In other words, God now become a servant, and you are now the captain of your destiny. And God is not confined in a small box. He is the one who is the master, and above all, He is the king. The king has the command, and the king has authority, and the king has power. Don't go beyond that. So it's not based in your time. And then you can see here, following the Lord, we can extend the invitation to you. It is not based in your emotional reaction according to that moment when you are saying the Lord, whatever. I go to the mountain, I go to the valley. Lord, I love you, I want to follow you. And then there comes a problem. Lord, I don't think I am in the right place. Could you, I'm very sorry. Maybe I can postpone that, my commitment to follow you. When our dependency is in our emotion, which means emotion is not final, it is fluctuating like the waves of the sea. If you respond based in your good feeling, you'll be in trouble because you can be disqualified to become soldiers and servants of Jesus Christ. So in the first place, from the moment you commit your life to the Lord, it is not based in your convenience. It is not based in your own time. Lord, I will stay in a certain city for 5 or 10 years. That is boasting. And boasting to the Lord, who are you? Can you make the one of your hair white or black? Can you add another month to your life before I take you home? No. So all your words must be yes, or all your words must be no when it is no. And so it is not based in emotion, because God is looking to your willingness to say, Lord,
amen.
When I say yes to you, I love this. When I turn over my life to you, I give it into your hand, this is me. Since I trust you, that I don't care, I believe everything will be taken care of. That's me. I put it negative, I don't care, negative word. I don't care what's going tomorrow. I believe in you, Lord, and I know you will supply my need.
Amen.
But on the positive note, when I talk over my life to you, Lord, I thank you. You're in charge, and I trust in you. That's the positive note.
Hallelujah.
So it's a beautiful thing to see, you know. So don't decide there's based on your emotion, in what you feel, or convenience, or in your time, because God is the a condition. Don't make a condition to the Lord because He is so plain. Emotion is not dependable. There is a quotation many years ago that I read many years ago, said, love at first sight. That's so in love. Then what happened after that divorce, the first fight? Because I have counseled people, these are, one is a chemist, another was a teacher, they are 60, 62 years of age, and they were married, and I was a counselor, they were not members of a big church, I was pastoring, I was one of the pastors of Calvary Chapel. I said, you know, pastor, they are looking for a minister, maybe they are looking for a tall, you know, and minister who is in charge. I was in charge. I had 2 days as a counselor of a 3,500 church in America. And they came, and then we're going to divorce after 1 month. Something happened. So to make the story short, I counseled them. They were restored because there was not unfaithfulness, there was lagging. So one month, but they got that honeymoon. After 1 month honeymoon, they want to divorce. It's a true story. It's time.